Awesome. So everybody can hear me? Great. Should we shut the door? Okay, awesome. All right, so my name's Ben. I'm from Twitter, and I'm going to be talking about building and running distributed systems on Mesos. For those of you that came to the earlier talk today about Mesos, this is really Mesos through a programmer's perspective. This talk's more focused on that, and in particular, for those distributed systems engineers in the audience, hopefully this will address how Mesos might be able to help you build one of your future distributed systems. So here's the agenda. There's kind of really two parts. There's some quick motivation and a little bit of Mesos from a distributed systems programmer perspective. That's one and two. And then we're going to spend the rest of the talk actually talking about some more low-level stuff. It'll end up sort of being a walkthrough of the Mesos system from a programmer's perspective, but it'll be pretty low level. I'll be showing some code and some protocol buffer messages and sort of talking about how they work. So hopefully this talk, for those people that are actually interested in building distributed systems on Mesos, can act as the start of a tutorial for you all, for you all to try something out yourself. Okay, so let me jump into it. First, you're building a distributed system. So some of these slides I pulled from a talk I gave last fall at a Future Stack. So for many of you, not all of you, but for many of you, applications, your applications that you're writing today don't fit on a single computer. Either your applications are processing a lot of data, big data, more data than we can fit on a single machine, or your applications have tons of users. And for most of you, especially if your company is doing well, these things are growing every day, and oftentimes faster than hardware is able to keep up with them. These kind of applications need tremendous amounts of resources, lots of CPUs, lots of memory, more than a single computer can really provide. Really, these applications need data centers or very large clusters to run. And for most applications, the data center really is the new computer for this class of applications. So, you know, for most people, what this basically means is that there's really no getting around it. You're building a distributed system. And this is not my quote. This is actually from ACMQ, from Mark Cavage. I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing his name correctly, but this is a great paper. You should go check it out. And it describes why it's very likely that you yourself are also building a distributed system. Okay, so how can Mesos help? Well, if we take a step back and we look for a second at distributed system anatomy, and there's an asterisk here because my PhD advisor would be very upset if I classed all distributed systems like this, but these are the distributed systems I'm going to focus on with respect to Mesos. And these distributed systems are really made up of some notion of a coordinator and some number of workers. There could be many coordinators, or it could be one, but it's some notion of there's some centralized entity that's doing things, and then it has many workers across some number of machines. And the coordinator is really at the heart of this kind of distributed system. It's doing a bunch of things, but we can call out three things in particular. One is it's running processes and tasks, and it's trying to do that simultaneously. That's why it's a distributed system. The second is that it's trying to actually handle process failures. It's trying to be a fault-tolerant distributed system so that when things fail, it can figure out other things it might want to run or rerun those things. And in some cases, it's actually trying to do things in an optimized way, for example, being elastic or doing something else. Of course, not all distributed systems try to optimize, but if we kind of looked at the three buckets of things that classified a bunch of distributed systems, these are the things. And if you took a step back and you looked at these three things, really what they're trying to do is to coordinate execution. That's why it's called a coordinator, right? It's really trying to coordinate the execution of the work that you're trying to do to accomplish some task. So this talk was titled Building Distributed Systems on Apache Mesos, but maybe I should have called it Building Frameworks on Apache Mesos, because in Apache Mesos, we don't actually call the things that we run on top distributed systems, we actually call them frameworks. But in the vocabulary of Mesos, you can really think of a framework as effectively a distributed system, and what kind of distributed system? The one I was referring to with coordinators and workers. In fact, if we were to look at frameworks from the perspective of Mesos, we don't call them coordinators and we don't call them workers. We call them schedulers, and we call them tasks or executors. And I'm going to get into more detail about tasks and executors later. For those of you that came to the earlier talk, you might have gotten a little bit of a preview of what those things look like. Okay, so scheduler. Scheduler sounds like kind of a scary term, something that people get PhDs to write. Why did we call it a scheduler? Well, execution coordination, as I described what the coordinator is most likely doing, those things, it's really just a form of scheduling. So you can really just think of scheduler, coordinator is really the same thing. It's doing some form of execution coordination, which is deciding what task it wants to run. So where does Mesos come into this? Well, Mesos really provides a level of indirection for these distributed systems that are being built. Rather than the schedulers needing to communicate directly with the machines themselves, from a programmer's perspective, Mesos really puts this level of indirection in between, and the schedulers communicate directly with Mesos, and Mesos manages all the machines under the covers for them. So why is this beneficial? Well, the first one, and from a programmer's perspective, I think this is the biggest thing to take away maybe from this talk, is that by providing that level of indirection, you can provide some common functionality that pretty much every distributed system otherwise has to re-implement. So most distributed systems, when someone sits down and they want to write their next distributed system, they re-implement failure detection, task distribution, task starting, task monitoring, so forth and so on. So by putting a level of indirection in an API that programmers can leverage to build their distributed systems, they can all leverage this common infrastructure. So that's really the first nice thing about this level of indirection. And the second one is that by having this level of indirection now, we can actually run multiple distributed systems on the same set of machines, and we can dynamically share the same set of resources. In fact, we can dynamically share the same set of resources on an individual machine. And so sort of coupled with a level of indirection, what Mesos ends up really providing is this level of abstraction. This level of abstraction, which is away from machines and towards resources. So I wanted to spend just a few slides really quickly highlighting this level of abstraction, because for those of you that are trying to understand where something like Mesos fits in the world of the cloud and everything else, I hope this will help. So from Mesos' perspective, especially for programmers trying to build distributed systems, the abstraction is really resources. It's an API for building and running frameworks with the abstraction being resources. So it's clearly higher, a higher level abstraction than infrastructure as a service. That abstraction is really provisioning and managing machines. And it's also lower than something like a PaaS, a platform as a service, whose abstraction is really about deploying and managing these collections of tasks, these jobs, these applications, or these services. But what's interesting about Mesos is that you can easily build and run something like a PaaS on top of Mesos, leveraging the Mesos API. And you can also run Mesos directly on infrastructure as a service. So there was a question in earlier session about how would something like Mesos and CloudStack relate. They can actually compose with one another. You can run Mesos directly on something like OpenStack, CloudStack, EC2. A nice aspect here, though, is that you can run Mesos directly on hardware as well. So it gives you that level of abstraction, so you could even move your software between physical machines or virtual machines, a virtual environment. And so because it kind of sits in between these two, this is why we really refer to it kind of like a kernel, because it provides this common functionality. It's not at a high level abstraction. It's not at the lowest level abstraction. It's somewhere more in between. Okay, so that's kind of, you know, from a programmer's perspective, what is this Mesos thing? How might it be useful to me? And now we're going to actually jump into the API, the actual API, if you wanted to program something on Mesos. And this is where we'll get a bit more technical, but it'll also kind of sort of walk you through some of the features and the fundamental aspects of Mesos sort of through a programmer's perspective. All right. So the first component of the API that I'm going to be talking about is the scheduler, and that, again, is the distributed system coordinator that's communicating with Mesos. So there's really two core components here. The scheduler and Mesos communicate through things called calls and events. So I call these out specifically because the programming model in Mesos is this really low-level, unreliable one-way message passing. So calls are things that go from the scheduler to Mesos itself, in this case, the Mesos master, and events are things that the Mesos master generates and gives to a scheduler. So you can kind of think about this like an actor-like programming model, except the messages are well-known and they're all typed. So why does Mesos at its core really have this message passing model? There's really two reasons. One is that request response was really insufficient because Mesos wants to be able to generate events or things for the schedulers at arbitrary times, not just based on when a request has been made, but at any arbitrary time. And that's why it's called an event, not a response. And you'll kind of get a better understand for this a little bit later as we talk some more. And then the other reason is that failures in these distributed systems really often mean that you need to be doing some other higher level reconciliation anyway. Just because you didn't get a response from a request doesn't mean that that request was not successful. So we kind of just broke to the lowest level API and said, okay, let's just be message passing. Let's have these primitives, calls and events, and let's provide mechanisms on top for doing higher level reconciliation. Okay, so calls. So on the scheduler side, there's a collection of calls, and I've kind of called them out here more or less by the sort of the types. So for running a scheduler, there's some lifecycle management calls, things like register, re-register, unregister. Then there's resource allocation, things like requesting resources, declining resources that have been allocated to a framework, reviving any filters that might have been put on the requests or the declined resources, and then finally task management. Actually launching, killing a task, acknowledging that the status of a task, or doing any sort of reconciliation about what you think that task might be doing and what that task is actually doing in the data center. And the events that a scheduler might receive are things like, well, again, lifecycle management, has it registered or has it recently re-registered? Has it been offered allocation of resources? These are called offers. Has it been rescinded? Some allocation of resources, or is there an update for a particular task? An update being, this is the current state of the task. So I'm going to walk through what this kind of looks like in a timeline. What a scheduler first does when it wants to try and run some tasks on Mesos is it will send a register to the Mesos master. The Mesos master, once it understands this stuff, does whatever authentication it needs to do with the scheduler, will say, okay, great, you're registered, so that's a call and an event. At this point in time, after register, the scheduler will be able to receive offers, but if it has specific resource requests that it'd like to make, it can make those in something called a request. Now, I want to highlight here, because this has often been a tricky point for a lot of people that have been playing around with Mesos, that requests are not actually required. They're hints that the main allocator can use for making resource allocations, but you can start getting offered resources right away without even making a request. So an offer is events where the master has allocated some resources for this framework. Given these resources, the scheduler can now decide what tasks it might want to run. Once it makes those decisions, it can send a launch to the master. The master uses this information to then propagate the launch to whatever individual machine is going to be running these tasks and handling that. Another offer of resources might come in. This is one of those events that will continually be generated regardless of whether or not the scheduler is actually making a request for anything. The resource offers will continue to come in. And at some point in time, an update for the task that was previously launched will also come in. And this update will say either the task is running, the task has failed, the task was lost because the box where it started running had failed, so forth and so on. Okay, so that's great. That's sort of a high-level overview of what the API looks like. Now let's jump in and understand how you could actually use those things given today's code in Mesos. So today you can actually build a framework on Mesos using C++, Java, or Python APIs that are supported by the project directly in Tree. So any changes that are made to the project that relate to the framework API itself, we make sure that we update these things. There's also a handful of bindings out of Tree There's Go, actually written by Nicholas right back here. There's Ruby bindings, there's Erlang bindings, Haskell. Caveat, your mileage may vary with some of these. I think some of them were people's hacking projects, and some of them were because they actually used them to build a framework that they ran at their company. If you reach out to those developers, I think they'll be able to give you a better idea of the viability of them. One of the things that I want to mention is the APIs that I'm going to be talking about that are exposed in C++, Java, and Python are really what we call the medium-level APIs, which is a weird term, but what I kind of showed you in some previous slides was really the low-level API, and we sort of wrap that around what you'll see in a second, which is this medium-level API, and we're actually working on exposing the lower-level API, and I'll explain why that might be useful to some people in the future. Okay, so first, events. So to actually receive events, this is going to be Java as well. I'm using Java as the lowest common denominator language, so everyone hopefully can get some idea. So for receiving events, you can implement what we call it is a scheduler, which kind of makes sense. That's the coordinator component that receives events. So to receive something like a registered event, you would get the registered callback. To get a re-registered event, you'd get the re-registered callback, so forth and so on for all the event types that I talked about in the previous slides. To make a call, you use something called a scheduler driver. And a scheduler driver basically has the calls as methods that you can evoke sending the necessary information that you would need. So in this case, to do a register, you call start. So why is it start and not register? This is a artifact of, in C++, register is a keyword. So start is how you do a register. To do a launch, you can call launch, passing the task information, so forth and so on. So then these two structures, a scheduler driver and a scheduler, end up getting composed to actually communicate with Mesos. So first you create something like your scheduler, represented by the box at the bottom as well. And then you create your scheduler driver, which communicates directly with Mesos, passing your scheduler so you can receive the events, some information about your framework, which I'll talk about a little bit later when we do a deeper dive on registration. And the scheduler driver is really the thing that's responsible for communicating with Mesos, for finding where Mesos is in case that there's multiple Mesos masters and one has failed over, for dealing with any other types of network partition issues. And really what the scheduler driver is doing is it's taking the low-level events, converting them into the callbacks on the scheduler, and taking the medium-level calls on scheduler driver and turning them into the low-level calls and passing them onto Mesos. That's kind of the glue. That's what we kind of call it a medium-level API. It's somewhere in between the low-level API and what you use in the code. So just for full disclosure, in today's world, when you actually use this, what you're really using is, when you're using a scheduler driver in any of the languages, is you're actually linking against a native library, libmesos, which does a lot of the work under the covers for you. And one of the reasons why we're trying to expose the lower level API is because the protocol that we actually use between the libmesos and Mesos itself is just HTTP. And so ultimately what we're trying to do is being able to eliminate that libmesos completely and let people write a native language scheduler driver. And that way you don't have to deal with trying to ship around a libmesos to also run your framework or executors or anything else like that. But today, the way it works is you'll have to grab that libmesos and couple it with your whatever you're running, whether it be a Java application or a Python or Go or whatever it is that you're running. Okay. All right, so now I'm gonna do a deeper dive. I'm gonna dive into a couple of the core things that you might do if you were building a Mesos framework. And again, in doing this, you'll be able to get an idea for how some of the Mesos features actually work, which is kind of fun from a programmer's perspective. Okay, so before I go any farther though, protocol buffers are really the main types that you'll use if you're using Mesos. The scheduler and the scheduler driver interfaces that I described before, that's pretty much the extent of the interfaces of the types that you'll use beyond just protocol buffers. Pretty much after that, you're just using protocol buffers for everything. which is one of the reasons why it makes it so easy to actually go do something like this and rip out the native stuff, is because we pretty much just speak protobufs. Okay, so registration. Let's start with registration. So the point of registration is really to tell Mesos that you're a framework that's running that would like to get offered resources, and here's some information about your framework. To do that, you use the framework info protocol buffer, and I'm going to walk through a bunch of the aspects of the framework info protocol buffer and see how they relate to a framework running on Mesos. So this is really at this point where you're doing a register from the scheduler to a Mesos master. Okay, so the user. So what's the user for? Well, the user specifies the username. Note this is not a user ID, this is a username that you want your tasks or your executors to run as. So in some cases, this might be root. Some of the work that we're actually doing is to be able to move this to individual tasks themselves, but right now as a framework, you'll run all your tasks as the same user. Okay. Unless you specifically switch user yourself, which you of course could when you start running your task. Okay. Next is the name. This is basically the human readable identifier for your framework. Those of you that went to the Aurora talk earlier today, that is Twitter scheduler. It could be whatever you want. For Hadoop, it's Hadoop. For Storm, it's Storm. For Marathon, it's Marathon. There's also, though, a machine readable identifier. And the machine readable identifier is really what gets set by the Mesos master itself, and that a framework uses to make its calls, to receive events, to register, and to re-register in the face of failover. So failover. So what does this mean, re-register in the face of failover? Well, in Mesos' case, it's possible that a scheduler that's connected and communicating with a Mesos master might indeed fail. And if it does fail, another framework scheduler can fail over and reconnect to Mesos with that same framework ID, and provided it also gets authenticated, then it will resume the responsibility of running the tasks for the previous scheduler that was running. So why is failover a pretty integral part of Mesos? Well, machines fail, obviously. Sometimes there's bugs in the schedulers, but it's also sometimes the case that you need to bring a scheduler down because you want to upgrade it to a later version, and you want to keep all of the tasks that had previously launched running. So failover is a really integral point. And in failover case, you're not doing register, but you're actually doing re-register, hence the little RE in front of the register. Okay, related to this is what we call the failover timeout. So not all frameworks actually want to be able to fail over. Some frameworks don't have the ability to deal with the fact that if they fail, they can reconcile their state and keep doing things. Hadoop One is a great example of this, and there's lots of other ones as well. So in that case, they don't care about failover. They would just be setting failover timeout to zero, which means that if they go away, assume that all tasks that had been launched should just get shut down and don't keep anything running. So this is a timeout, which is a little bit interesting because in practice we've noticed that people don't really care about, a 65-second failover or a 3-minute failover. They pretty much want an infinite failover, don't kill any of my tasks forever, or kill my tasks right away. So if you want failover, you probably just want to set this to max double because you want to keep your stuff running forever until the next process comes up. But it's a double, so if you can somehow take advantage of that, by all means, go for it. Okay, so checkpoint. So the checkpoint flag is a rather important one. What does this mean from a programmer's perspective? Well, on the individual slave, when I run my tasks, it's possible that the slave might also die, or again, because we're upgrading the slave might be shut down and then restarted. And in that case, there's a question of whether or not I, as a framework, want to deal with the overhead of having a task launched where information is first checkpointed, such that when the slave comes back online, it can find these tasks. So to actually checkpoint this for information requires some work. Some people really don't care about it. They want to be able to run their tasks on Mesos in sub-millisecond times. And to actually deal with checkpointing some data is unacceptable. So in certain cases, these are frameworks like Spark that want to be able to launch tasks very, very, very fast. So for that reason, checkpoint is something explicitly that you can call out. If you don't want that functionality, you don't have to have it. It just means that when that slave goes down, all your tasks on that slave will get killed. Otherwise, When that slave goes down, all your tasks will continue to run. Okay, next is role. So role is really it's the organization or the group in which the framework that you're running should take resources from. So something I'm not really talking about here today is operationally how you can make sure that certain numbers of resources are reserved for different roles, different groups. And when a framework actually registers, it can specify what role it should receive these resources as. And that's how we can actually do some resource reservations work, some fare sharing, so forth and so on. Depending on how much time I have in the talk, if that's interesting, I've got some backup slides. We can talk a bit more about how some of that stuff actually works. Okay, and finally, hostname. This is just a local hostname for the framework, so we can sort of phone home if you guys have a web UI. So there's a bunch of frameworks that run on Mesos that themselves have web UIs, and sometimes for operators, it's nice to be able to link back to those actual web UIs. Okay, so the second deep dive, so that was registration. So the second deep dive that I wanted to dive into was offers. Deep dive I wanted to dive into, okay. So offers is really, it's the primitive that provides resource allocation in Mesos. And the way offers really work is they're resource allocations that are made to the schedulers. They get to pick and choose based on what allocations have been made, what they want to use to actually run their tasks. So this is the protobuf that represents the offer. And just like framework info, I'm going to walk through those pieces. So where does offer kind of fit in this timeline? It's here. And again, offer is an event that will be generated regardless of whether or not a framework actually requested it. It's a recurring event that will always be happening. Okay. So the offer ID is a machine readable identifier for the offer. I'm skipping a few now. I'm going to sort of jump to some of the more interesting bits. The slave ID is the machine readable identifier of the slave in which these resources were originally from. The resources are the resources that are available on this slave for you to possibly run tasks. And the bottom two are some extra bits. There's some attributes, which I talk about a little bit later, so we'll just do it then. Okay. All right, and then finally launch, so that's offer, that's actually receiving some allocation of resource, and finally there's launch. And launch is when a scheduler finally decides, okay, given these resources that have been allocated to me, what tasks do I want to run, or possibly what executor? And the task info structure is what describes the tasks that you actually want to run. The task is really the primitive in Mesos, not a container, not an executor. The real bit is the task, and I'll show you how the other pieces kind of work around that. Okay, so this is where we are now. We've received an offer of resources. Now we're actually trying to launch our tasks. Okay, so tasks have a human-readable identifier. They also have a machine-readable identifier. This must be unique. You can kind of think of this like the PID for your framework. The resources that this task is actually consuming. Note that this might be less than the offer. This might be a subset of the resources that were actually offered to you. Okay, and now we start to get to some interesting stuff. There's two optional fields here that you can set. One which specifies what we call an executor, and the other one which specifies just what we call a command. And I want to dive into both these things because from a programmer's perspective, this is really some important stuff. Okay, so if you're launching a task with a command, effectively what that means, from a programmer's perspective, is that this command was just some command line that got launched with shell, and that's the command, and it's just a task that you ran on some slave, okay? You can run multiple tasks on the same slave with different commands. Now, if you're launching a task with an executor, instead, what happens is that an executor gets launched for you, and then the task gets passed to the executor, and the executor decides how that task should actually get run. So what the executor really does in Mesos is it provides someone who's building a framework a level of indirection for deciding how they might want to actually realize their tasks. The reason why this might be interesting is that, well, you could run multiple tasks within the same executor, and you could also run tasks. You could realize them in whatever way you want. They don't have to be shell commands. They can, if you want, just be threads. You can realize, so the task really is the unit of resources that are being consumed, and you can decide how, as an executor, you want that task to actually be executed. Okay. Of course, if you run an executor on a slave, that doesn't preclude you from running tasks without executor on the same slave as well. So you can run an executor, you can run many tasks underneath that executor, you can also run tasks without executor. You can mix and match based on whatever it is that you're trying to do. Okay, so what's really interesting about this design is it lets us get fine-grained isolation on the slave nodes themselves as well. And what I mean by that is when we talk about containerization, the containerization is really around either an individual task or the combination of the executor and tasks that are run underneath it. So what's great about that is since you can pass multiple tasks to the same executor, these are the containers, they're noted by dotted lines. As you pass multiple tasks to the same executor, this allows us to actually change the resource constraints on the container dynamically. So you can scale up and scale down the container based on the number of tasks that you're actually trying to run inside of that container. So there are a bunch of frameworks which can actually take advantage of that. Hadoop 1 is an example. Spark is a big example. Storm is an example when it wants to say scale up because its queues are getting bigger and then scale down, so forth and so on. Okay. And then this is the scaling down of the tasks. All right. As Adam and Nicholas talked about in an earlier talk, coming soon is the ability to actually launch your container with a specific image. So you can actually say, I want to run this task. Give me a container, but use this image for my container. And that container image could be a Docker image, which is great. So we can make it even easier for you to distribute the bits that you need to actually run your tasks. Okay, so I talked just about this the executor, so I want to briefly talk about the other side of the API in Mesos, which is really the executor API, and it's not required. You don't need to implement the executor API if you don't want to, because you can just launch tasks. But if you do want to implement the executor API, and we zoom in for a second on the executor, just like the scheduler, it's really consists of two components, calls and events. This is actually swapped. The two arrows should be in another direction. I apologize. Calls are going from the executor to the Mesos slave, and events are coming from the Mesos slave to the executor. Okay, so what are examples of executor calls? There are things like register, re-register, unregister. This should look very, very familiar. There are things like update, so you can actually provide updates to the task that you're running, some status updates for the tasks that are actually running. The events you can receive are things like registered, re-registered, shutdown. Again, these should look very, very familiar. And the other events you receive are things like launch, which is launch this task, or kill, which is this task should actually be killed. So launch and update are kind of the two core ones. So what does that look like? Well, a Mesos slave would generate the event launch, pass it to the executor and say, the framework has requested that this executor launch this task info, which I described earlier. The executor, again, can choose however it wants to actually realize the launching of that task. It could be a thread, it could be nothing. It could just use whatever threads it already has. If another launch comes in, again, the executor can decide what it wants to do with that. But it's the executor's responsibility at this point in time to say, okay, well, here's the update for these tasks that we're actually running. These are task statuses, so forth and so on. So if you're just launching the task, all that sort of launching, updating is really taken care of for you, killing is taken care of for you, but the executor really gives you this nice level of indirection so you can do more things yourself if you want to do those things. Okay, great. So for most programmers that are going to be playing around with building a distributed system on Mesos, your two lifelines are really going to be the web UI and the CLI. So I can't really talk about programming a distributed system in Mesos without really covering those real quick. There's a handful of command line tools you can use that make it easier for working with a framework on Mesos. If you've installed Mesos, you can just run Mesos. It kind of works like Git. It's got a bunch of subcommands. You can pull those subcommands. The ones I wanted to call out here were things like cat and tail. So you can actually cat and tail files in the sandbox of the tasks that are actually running. Things like SCP, so you can copy data on if you need to. So there's also PS, so you can actually see all the tasks that you have running, and as I mentioned, cat and tail. this will give you standard out, standard error, and it'll also let you cat and tail any other files you have in there. So if you have like a very specific log file, you've got some other file that you're putting data on, you can cat and tail those files as well. And then the other resource is really the web UI. So this is what the web UI looks like. Sorry, I'm not showing a live demo. Basically, what you see on the homepage is the active tasks that you have running and the completed tasks that you have running. For most framework builders, the most important thing is kind of clicking through to the sandbox. The sandbox will show you the files in your sandbox that are being created. Automatically, you have a standard out and you have a standard error file that's getting created. You can tail those files right there by just clicking on them. You can also download them. The nice thing about the web UI and all these features is it's completely a REST interface. So as was mentioned in the earlier talk as well, you can hit the REST interface with whatever tools or systems that you have. You don't have to use the web UI. You don't have to use the command line interface. There's lots of actual endpoints that might be of value to you. And to find out about those, you can go to any Mesos master and just hit /help, the Mesos master IP /port/help, and it will actually tell you all the different REST endpoints that you can hit. It's kind of like our man for Mesos. Gives you some nice explanations of those endpoints. Okay, so that's where I'm going to conclude. So I'm happy to take questions, and if there are particular things that people want to jump into, I have some backup slides because based on some of the questions from earlier the earlier talk, I thought I'd be prepared. But that's where I'll stop for now.
Hello. I have one question. The tasks in the executors, which you can submit, can you give some kind of dependencies among them? Is it allowed?
So, would you like me to repeat the question, or since it's on mic?
Yeah, it's on mic.
Okay, I'll repeat it since the audience asked. So the question is are there some sort of dependencies between the tasks and the executors?
Only the tasks.
Only the tasks. Is there a dependency between the tasks? Nope. There's no dependency. There's no dependencies between the tasks. That doesn't mean that a higher level framework can't actually explicitly require there to be some dependencies in how those tasks get executed. So Kronos, which was a framework which was talked about in the morning talk, is distributed cron specifically with dependencies. So you describe to Kronos the different tasks and the dependencies that they have, and then Kronos takes care of making sure that using Mesos it launches those tasks in their dependent ordering.
Okay, thanks. So you mentioned that by setting the checkpoint to false, something like that I can have the task get killed if the slave daemon is kind of died.
Yep, that's right. Yep.
But in that case, who is going to kill the task if the slave is not running? If the slave process is not running, who is going to kill the running task?
Okay, so the question is if the slave process is not running, who's going to actually kill the task? So for every task that gets launched, we effectively launch a little task in between, a little process in between, which monitors whether or not the slave is present. And that's built into the executor. But for the individual task that we run without an executor, it uses what's called the command executor to deal with that. That doesn't change very much. That code is really, really basic and simple. So it's a good place to put the code to make sure that the tasks always get cleaned up.
Okay, so if you want to run multiple tasks inside an executor, the way it works is sort of, let's say you're starting your first task in it, you specify the resources you want, executor grows to the size that accommodates that task, then you specify another task, specify resources, and it grows to accommodate both those tasks. Is that sort of how it works?
Exactly, yep.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, so I'll just repeat the question. So the question was about the semantics about how the resource constraints around a container grow as you run more tasks. So what ends up happening is you have resource constraints around just the executor when it starts. The executor is also a consumer of resources. When it starts, a container is put around it, which constrains the executor. As a task gets passed to the executor, the container is grown. As the task finishes, and it could finish because a terminal status update was sent, the container would shrink. As more tasks come, the container would grow again, so forth and so on.
So
So what are the zookeeper requirements for your masters? And then how many masters can you have up and running at any point in time?
Okay, so the question is, what are the zookeeper requirements for the masters? And how many masters could you have up and running at any point in time? So zookeeper is only used for leader election. So you can point all the slaves, the frameworks, and the masters to zookeeper just to determine who the leading master is. So the requirements in zookeeper are quite low. And there's an outstanding Mesos Jira issue to actually eliminate that requirement altogether. So you could just launch Mesos with some number of masters, and it itself can do its own leader detection. We already have that support for the registry, which was mentioned in the earlier talk, which is how we maintain our state, which is effectively a replicated log. How many masters can you have up and running? In production at Twitter, we've run 3 and 5. I think we're almost running 5. You could run many more if you wanted to. 3 has been sufficient for a pretty long time. But you could run 10. So perhaps the important aspect here is that only one master is really active at a time. The other masters are passive standbys. That might change in the future, but that's the current architecture.
How many slaves can one master deal with?
Okay, so the question is, how many slaves can one master deal with? So unfortunately, I can't share publicly the number of machines we run on Twitter, at Twitter. What I can share is the simulations that we've done, and I'll explain the setup for the simulation. So what we do is we'll take a master on a single physical machine, we'll say take 100 other machines, and we'll run some number of slaves on those machines. One slave, 10 slaves, 100 slaves, so forth. And I was actually chatting with a gentleman earlier today who said that he was replicating some of this stuff and was running up to like 5,000 slaves, I think. 7,000, okay. But that's just on one physical machine. But what we've done with those simulations is then ran the number of slaves that are connecting and sending control traffic back and forth with the Mesos master up to about 50,000 simulated slaves. And what these simulated slaves are doing is basically we're running some number of frameworks, and those frameworks are just connecting to the Mesos master, and any available resources which are coming from all these slaves are just being allocated immediately, and the jobs, the tasks that we're running are just sleep 1 second, basically. So it's not like we're doing a lot of work on these 100 physical machines. We're really just trying to test the amount of control traffic that's being passed back and forth. And at that point in time is when we start to notice there's some overhead in the Mesos master, and the amount of time that it takes to run a 1 second sleep task starts to become like 1.3 seconds, 1.4 seconds, so forth and so on, which means there's queuing in the system, there's some backlogs, so forth and so on. And we run these simulations because there are production instances of Mesos that require numbers to be that size. Okay. Okay, great. So thanks so much. There's a bunch of us around for the rest of PachyCon, so please come seek us out. They're the Mesosphere guys, and then there's a bunch of other Twitter guys as well. So please come seek us out if you have more questions, and thanks so much for coming by.